Lisa, could we move to your presentation, and then Gail, when it's your turn, we'll get your introduction, and similarly for Sam.
Okay, I'll share my screen then.
Fabulous, thank you, Lisa.
Right. Oh, 1 second, it's just been a bit slow. Start again. That's annoying. Here we go. That one's working. Right. Hello, everyone. I'm going to read from notes because I'm not really used to public speaking. So I hope that's okay. So my name's Lisa Perry. Before I show you the wiki that I've made for my son, I want to start by telling you about his journey over the last few years, as it will help me explain the value of having the wiki. Then I'll demo the wiki and explain some of the benefits we've seen from its use and answer any questions you may have. After that, I'll hand over to Gail Hanrahan, who runs the Oxfordshire Family Support Network, to say a few words. Gail has been our family carer advocate for several years now, and having her alongside me throughout our journey has been invaluable. I think Gail's going to talk about how we started using wikis in Oxfordshire and some of the issues that need to be considered in order to set up a wiki for a family member. Can you see this, everyone?
Great.
Yeah, lovely. Okay, so these are my kids. Aidan, my son, is autistic and has a moderate to severe learning disability and epilepsy. On occasion, he exhibits behaviours which can be described as challenging to people. He may be aggressive or run away, both usually when he's distressed, and I prefer the term distressed behaviour to challenging behaviour. Aidan has had several admissions to hospital under the Mental Health Act. He has no mental health illness and has been in inpatient settings because of a lack of local services and staff who can meet his needs. Just a brief early years history. Following lack of speech development and avoidant behaviour, Aidan's autism was diagnosed when he was 2.5. Following a year in an SEN nursery, he joined his big sister in the local primary school, which had an autism base attached to it, which he attended from age 4 to 11. Time in the autism base was mostly good, and he integrated with the rest of the school where possible for PE, music, assemblies, anything which he enjoyed and could cope with. He did some good work here, and at the time he was especially into Lego and drawing, especially roads and houses, you can see there. As he approached puberty, he found it harder to be amongst his peers and spent a lot of time on his own in a separate classroom. Aggressive behaviour and medication started. He completely lost the ability to draw, possibly due to medication causing stiffness. When the time came to transfer to secondary school, Aidan spent a couple of transition visits at the school which had been identified, and it didn't go well. He didn't want to be there and went around ripping up other students' work. It was decided that no local school could meet his needs. Eventually, a residential school 3 hours away from home was chosen, and he moved here at age 11. He was very homesick and wanted to call us every day and save a number of sleeps till he was coming home. Over the 4 years he was here, he did have some good experiences, but ultimately he found living alongside others who may be distressed very difficult. There were high levels of restraint, and at age 14, he was permanently excluded with 2 days' notice. Following exclusion, boots on the ground support was scant despite involvement of lots of different agencies, and there was no place for respite or education. The education authority's property previously used for those like him out of school had been sold. And this coincided with his dad's admission to hospital with a brain infection. We asked for help, and Aidan was sectioned and spent 6 months in an adolescent unit in a hospital in Birmingham. Once his dad had recovered, we fetched him out every weekend and either went to stay with family in Birmingham or brought him home. His name was Dan for a brand new residential school in Oxford, and we would drive past with him to see it being built. What didn't go so well, as you can see here, he found living alongside others with distressed behaviour very difficult. who was given high doses of PRN medication, as needed medication. I would visit and find him practically comatose and drooling. Also, there were high levels of restraint, as you can see here. On arrival at the unit, because Dad was in hospital, I travelled with him in the secure transport. When the time came for me to go, he wanted to come home with me, and I left him there being restrained by five men. When the local school was ready, Aidan transferred back to Oxford. The school head reported he was happy enough when he was being supported by staff on his own, but again found it extremely difficult living alongside others with distressed behaviour. Just 6 weeks after he started at the school, he witnessed a fellow pupil having a seizure and being taken away by paramedics, and had an incident where he was aggressive to teachers and broke a door panel, possibly trying to get to his bedroom. He also hit his community psychiatrist who was there that day, and he was taken away by police in leg restraints. He was admitted to the local adolescent mental health unit, where he spent 8 months in segregation. The majority of other patients in the unit had actual mental health difficulties. Because of his autism and learning disability, the unit did not have the expertise to care for Aidan, and at times he became very distressed. He was kept in seclusion for long periods, once for 9 hours. The rule was he had to be settled for an hour, which was impossible due to his sensory presentation. Agency learning disability nursing staff were brought in, and this worked well. Clinicians from learning disability and autism inpatient units across the country assessed him and agreed with us that he'd been thoroughly assessed already and his needs were well understood. They also recommended bespoke community support locally. A care and treatment review took place. Care and treatment reviews had only recently been introduced as a response to the Winterbourne View scandal a few years earlier. A number of recommendations were made around the local authorities starting to put into place bespoke single person support locally and finding an interim provision for Aidan whilst this was being set up, estimated to be approximately a year. We visited over 20 provisions across the country, but found nowhere could provide him with the single person support he needed. Everywhere was a replication of the settings already tried in which he had struggled, sharing space with others like himself. CTR recommendations for the local authority to start setting up local support were not followed, and family was an impasse with local professionals. Subsequently, a mental health tribunal decided that as no suitable interim provision had been found, Aidan would be transferred to St Andrews in Northampton, a large-scale learning disabilities unit. At this time, their adolescent unit had a CQC rating of requires improvement and has since been closed. Just to reiterate, psychiatrists have been brought in to assess him, supported the view he did not need inpatient assessment and treatment. This included the psychiatrist who became his responsible clinician at St Andrews. The primary reason for his long-term detention was the lack of suitable community provision. The first weekend he was here, they changed his medication and with no titration started him on olanzapine, which is an antipsychotic medication used to treat the symptoms of psychotic conditions such as schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. As a result, he had his first grand mal seizure for a couple of years. St Andrews had an extremely risk-averse approach to him having any leave. Very little opportunities for exercise outside the unit, together with side effects from olanzapine, caused severe constipation. He was taken to A&E, where his x-ray showed severe blockage of his large intestine. With Aidan's 18th birthday approaching, we involved legal services, which advised that the local authorities' continued delay in finding suitable housing was unlawful and the main cause for Aidan's delayed discharge. We also had extensive support from the Challenging Behaviour Foundation, Oxfordshire Family Support Network, and the Children's Commissioner for England and Wales, who visited St Andrews to meet Aidan, hospital, NDT and management, and the professionals involved locally to put pressure on plans for discharge. Aidan finally left St Andrews after having been on section for 22 months. His staff team was still incomplete and he had no housing. However, he was 18 and we were told that St Andrews needed his bed for another patient and threatened to transfer him to an adult ward on site. all agree this was not in Ada's best interests. He was discharged to a private rental bungalow in Oxfordshire. Near to the property we'd hoped would be his permanent home. He spent 6 months here, supported by United Response. The bungalow, chosen for its proximity to the house that was being purchased for Aidan, was not ideal. There were concerns about him running away. The property was on a dual carriageway. There were huge issues with neighbours. Aidan is very noisy. We had cars keyed, and on one occasion, the padlock to his gate was glued shut to prevent his return to the property. There were several issues with recruiting a robust staff team, and the last straw, after several months, the house purchase fell through. Aidan was resectioned in March 17 and spent the next 5 months at a private hospital 3 hours away from Oxford in Colchester. Despite having committed no crime, he was on a forensic adult male ward. At the time, it was rated as requires improvement, and the unit has since been closed by the CQC and reopened under another provider. Here again, Aidan had difficulties when others were showing distressed behaviour. You may notice I haven't spoken about assessment and treatment because as I said earlier, he'd already been very thoroughly assessed, and in reality, additional assessment and treatment has been of little added value. What worked well was the continued support of his local team whilst in Colchester, who were too paid over to a local provider, PBS4, and the fact that he was able to use his motability car. After 5 months, he was discharged back to his rental bungalow because we were still waiting for permanent housing for him. A few weeks later, he ran away from here and was knocked down by a car on the dual carriageway. Thankfully, he wasn't badly hurt. Family, his support team, and the driver who hit him were very shocked, though. The bungalow's proximity to the main road meant it was unsafe, and we were not willing to have Aidan go into yet another hospital for want of a property. So he came back to live with family for 6 months, with me, his dad, and his sisters. He was supported in the day by his 3-to-1 care team. It was lovely to have him home and to know he was safe. This is him celebrating Christmas with the family. His support team were good, but their position was difficult as Aidan just wanted family. Caring full-time for Aidan takes quite a toll on family life, and it was a very intense situation with 3 support workers constantly in the house. They were lovely, but there was nowhere for us all to sit, and our girls would spend all their time in their bedrooms, only coming down at 8 p.m. after support left. The third property earmarked for Aidan had been abandoned because it too was next to a busy road. Family had found a fourth property, but nothing was moving forward. Monthly respite, where Aidan would go to a house with the staff team for the weekend, fell through after Aidan damaged the doors and ran away. He was missing for several hours during a very cold February night. Our house also received quite a battering, and on the last day he was here, he broke the upstairs window catches and we couldn't keep him safe. We felt that we had no choice but to accept help again because the property issue was not moving, and we felt that to have him resectioned was the only way to get what we all knew was needed, a bespoke, robust property and team, near to family, but not with family. After all that he'd been through, this was a devastating decision. Aidan spent a month at a local 136 suite before being transferred in March 18 to another private hospital in Lincoln, 3 hours away from us. This was meant to be a short-term arrangement whilst the local authority secured appropriate accommodation, and discharge was originally planned for July 18, 4 months later. The house that family identified in December 2017 was finally bought in June 18. Discharge was then pushed back to August, then December, because community provision wasn't in place. The house needed some adaptations, and because his support provider had been stood down following his admission, there was no staff team for him in Oxford to come back to. He was here for 2 years and 3 months. The multidisciplinary team were very disconnected with the support team, and family and local clinicians were really unimpressed. Because the property wasn't ready, we were over a barrel, as the local commissioner termed it. At one point, we were so dissatisfied with his care here, transitioned to a hospital in Northumberland, 6 hours away from Oxford, was being considered. Work finally began on the property in the following June 2019. And after a protracted procurement process, support provider Seeability was engaged in late summer 2019. Once Seeability were on board, they started to recruit for his support team and plan Aidan's discharge. Aidan finally had a home of his own. The property was one of two new builds together. This was the specification for his service because of the backup which could be provided by the second house. This has been invaluable. The garage space of the other house has since been converted to an office, and the two houses together scenario was working really well. Adaptation works were finished in February 2020, and Aidan finally started having transition visits back to his home in March 2020. Then lockdown hit and transition visits were stopped. The local authority wanted to move another person into Aidan's house, which caused us much distress. But it was agreed by NHS England that any discharge that had already started should proceed. So after a few more weeks, transition visits resumed. Whilst the rest of the country was in lockdown, Aidan had quite a good few months. He had been in lockdown for the previous 2 years, but was now travelling from Lincoln to Oxford and back, and the transition visits were going really well. He finally left Lincoln and moved into his house in June 2020. As you can see from the photos, Aidan was very pleased to be in his new home. He had a lovely team around him, and the team were able to take him out on walks and spend time with him in his house. I'd like to be able to say this is the end, but there were a few incidents. Some of his team weren't used to the level of challenging behaviour he could sometimes exhibit. The showstopper was him managing to get over his 2 metre fencing and going to the neighbouring Seeability property. Despite there being multiple professionals involved in the adaptations, including 4 occupational therapists and approximately 30 site visits, we didn't foresee Aidan being able to go over 2 metre fencing. It was decided the property, and specifically the fencing, needed further adaptation, and a 3 metre fence was planned, which needed to go through the planning permission process, which takes several months. There was no alternative accommodation. At the end of July 2020, Aidan was taken to the local 136 suite, where he was put on an immediate section 3. A 136 suite is a place of safety used for up to 48 hours to house someone who's experiencing mental health distress. Aidan was not in distress. In fact, his dad and I took him ourselves to the 136 suite via the pub for a Coke. The reason he was there was due to the lack of an alternative property while his was being made safe. Following his admission, his community team were initially allowed in to support him. His dad or I would take him out on leave every few days for walks and to visit the pub, and he really valued this. The trust tried to transfer him to a learning disabilities unit, as is the usual way of things. The treatment Aidan required was transitioned back to his home 1 mile away from the current hospital. This was during the COVID lockdown, and if Aidan had been transferred, family and support would not have been able to visit. These units were rated inadequate and requires improvement by the CQC. And as you have heard, Aidan had already had several previous admissions where the provider has been stood down and staff lost. We were determined to keep the community team involved and for Aidan's life to carry on as normally as possible. His inpatient mental health responsible commission, initially supportive and understanding of the predicament, became increasingly risk averse and his care became much more restrictive. His noise levels, due to his sensory presentation, were construed as being too hyper after going out. And from the start of September, the responsible commission stopped his leave completely. Many independent expert learning disability clinicians became involved and stressed the importance of keeping him local to his home, community and support provider. We knew the futility and likely further trauma of yet another admission, and family sought a judicial review against his transfer. There was an ethics review to look at a proposed formulation which sought to distance his family. It was an extremely distressing time. This is Aidy on his last day out with Dad in the woods in September 2020 and the following February, 2 stone heavier. Following an incident in January involving one of his community support workers, Seeability were banned from working with him in the 136 suite. who is detained in seclusion within the 1-6 week for 16 whole days. That's locked up in his bedroom, basically, whilst a team of 10-1, predominantly made up of mental health agency workers, was recruited. Their approach included high levels of restraint. I witnessed Aidan being restrained in the prone face down position, saying, "Go to your room," which meant he was willing to go to his room. Despite this, the restraint continued and he received an intramuscular injection. The learning disability agency workers the ward had initially recruited had disappeared, I believe because of their objections onto how he was being treated. The planning permission and works to his house took several months but were finally completed. We were now in a ridiculous situation where Aidan's home was signed off and ready for him. Several of his support team were fully trained and based from his home, but not being allowed access to him. And the clinical opinion was that he needed to go to an LD inpatient unit for this to happen. Care and treatment reviews recommended his community team should be allowed access and the reinstatement of his leave. The community learning disability clinicians were in there every day trying to influence his care, but they were largely ignored. We had involvement of our legal team, NHS England and NHS Improvement. We had mediation with the senior management of the trust and promises made, but the responsible clinician refused to budge. The impasse led to a mental health ruling that transfer to an LD unit should happen. In July 2021, nearly a year after he was first taken to the 1-6 suite, Aidan was transferred to a single person unit in Brooklands Hospital in Birmingham. Professor Ashok Roy, who was his responsible clinician there, confirmed that Aidan needed no assessment or treatment, but he was offering a bed because of the local impasse. His suitability team were there to meet him and supported him 24/7 from day one. And Aidan was out on his Section 17 leave within the week. Within a couple of weeks, Aidan was going out with his team and family to Birmingham City Centre and having transition visits back to his home in Oxford. After 6 weeks spent in Brooklands, he moved back last August. Aidan has undoubtedly been scarred by the repeated admissions and especially the restrictions of the last admission. He has now been home for 7 months, again supported 3-1 with no restraint, little PRN as needed medication, and of course no seclusion segregation. That doesn't mean to say it has been an incident-free time, but any incidents are managed well and the team can withdraw from his space and check he's safe by CCTV. He has the run of his house and garden and goes out in his vehicle 3 times a day. The team at Seeability have been fabulous throughout and are slowly trying to stretch Aidan into doing all the things he used to enjoy. So, in summary, huge numbers of professionals from multiple organisations have been involved in Aidan's case. Apart from the last admission, where Aidan bed blocked a 1-6 bed for a year, and there were meetings practically daily, there has been lack of momentum. Family have driven the process and had to seek help from several voluntary advocates and charities. Aidan has autism and a learning disability. He has no mental health issues and has had frequent admissions due to lack of local services, specifically a suitable property and trained staff that can meet his needs. Counting local mental health units, Aidan has been in 7 different hospitals. He's now spent well over 2,000 days, nearly 6 years, a quarter of his life in hospital. He's finally in his bespoke local person-centred support service, as was recommended by his first NHS England CTR in 2015. Do you have any questions before I do his wiki? Okay, I'll go straight on to that then. Share screen. 1 second. Right, share screen again. Okay, can you all see that? Great. Okay, so Aidan's wiki is on a platform called MultiMe, which provides additional functionality, a diary, a place to store media, documents, presentations, photos and videos, calendar and obviously goals. And I'll just show who's Wiki's first. So this is Aidan's Wiki. It's like a private Wikipedia page about him. The Wiki is owned by the person or their family carer and can contain anything that they want. I've chosen these headings for Aidan's Wiki. When I first heard about Wikis, I was very motivated to make one for Aidan. I had known Gail Hanrahan from Oxfordshire Family Support Network for several years, and she had made what she called a drop-dead book, which contained everything someone would need to know about her son in order to support and advocate for him if she dropped dead. It had been my intention for some time to make a drop-dead book of my own, and instead I created a Wiki. When deciding on what to include, I wrote down all the information I wanted to share in there and organised this list into topics or headings, a bit like a table of contents for a book. Then I started to build it, adding content, pictures and videos to each Wiki page. The beauty of having a Wiki is it takes away the need to explain to every new person involved about Aidan, his history and how to support him. And as you've heard, he's got quite a history. As I expect with most of you, I've got a filing cabinet of information about him, thousands of documents, photos, much more in my head. Having a Wiki, I can present what I consider is important. As an example, I think we're on to our 18th version of his positive behavioural support plan. Current information is always on there and can easily be updated. If we suddenly find out about a new trigger or a new way of preventing a behaviour, it can be added to the Wiki and everyone with access to it can read about it or see a video. Because the Wiki is held on the internet, it's accessible from any device. The paper alternative to this is people getting out-of-date information or piles and piles of it which aren't read. The Wiki owner could be the person themselves or their representative, family or support worker. The Wiki owner can govern who sees what by section. For example, someone may not wish for everyone to read about their health conditions, or for a person with a forensic history, they might not want all the details of that history accessed by everyone. The thing I like most about the Wiki is I can put up photos and short videos of Aidan. Professionals who become involved may only get to see a person at their most distressed, or may only know them on paper. And as we all know, a picture paints a thousand words, and the Wiki contains all of the good stuff, the things that you can do rather than you can't. It's been especially useful for new support workers who can be given access to the Wiki and it brings Aidan to life for them. It's also been invaluable when he's been admitted to hospital. Often when a person is admitted, the notes forwarded with them are patchy or even absent, and the hospital may start from scratch to get to know a person, which can take months. The Wiki gives them a good background, and there have been times when it's been signposted in clinical reports. The responsible clinician during his time in the 1-6 week didn't look at it. If she had, she would have most likely gained a better understanding of his sensory presentation by looking at the videos I've put up there of him. The clinicians who have looked at it have learned a great deal about him, and it's been really well accepted. So just to quickly look around the Wiki, I'll open the All About Me section. Can you see that? Yeah. Okay. So this is fairly self-explanatory. It's all the little things, where Aidan fits within his family, the things that are important to him, music, food, favourite places, and also the bits and pieces, like don't give him a teaspoon to eat his pudding. He hates that because he likes a dessert spoon. Aidan communicates in simple sentences, mostly to get his needs met. He wouldn't be able to give you all this information himself. He may manage to protest by saying big spoon, but if that's not understood by support staff, it could cause an escalation. Of course, the important two, important four section can be easily updated as needed. And it's fairly intuitive to use. Most of us are using Facebook these days. And I would say that anyone who can add a photo on Facebook can set up a Wiki. I'll just show you. I've just opened this welcome to my Wiki section. I've put I put a one-page profile I made for him here, and also a PowerPoint presentation I did for the mediation sessions we had last year, just so those people involved could see photos and videos of Aidan doing stuff and having a good life. Okay, so I'll open live so far. So this is, can everybody see that okay? Has it changed all right? Yeah. This is history of his schools, placements, hospitals he's been in and when, but also the good stuff. Photos of him doing things and being with his family and stuff. And you can put, you know, whatever you think's important here, really. And you can expand and add as much text as you know as you like. Okay, so health section. I'll just show you his health section quickly. This health info contains his NHS number, GP details, diagnosis, a brief overview of his history and current meds list. Health and medication history, same but in much more detail. It has really important information about previous medications tried, what worked, what didn't, any side effects and why the medication was withdrawn. Regular health checks is a record of his latest appointments and results, blood tests, ECG, dental, eyesight, weight, etc. The epilepsy section is a history of his epilepsy, what to record when he has a seizure. There are videos of his seizures as well as absence and tonic-clonic seizures. He also has weird seizure types involving arm movements. In order to be able to identify seizures, support staff need to know what they're looking for, and clinical reports don't provide videos. I've also put his hospital passport on here. This is extremely helpful if he's ever taken his hospital in an emergency, for example, as well as important contacts and a brief health overview. It contains details of reasonable adjustments which can be made in order to support him in hospital. I recently made a visit to the dentist support plan, which I've also stored here. The how to support me section. So this is obviously, again, self-explanatory. It's just sort of more detail of how to support him. I won't open their behaviours at my challenge for you know, protection of his privacy, but this is all the positive behavioural support stuff, all of the proactive stuff that you can do to prevent any difficulties. And activities just contains all the things he's enjoyed and suggestions of things he might like to try. His sensory issues are a big thing with Aidan. His sensory presentation is probably the most significant thing about his autism, really. And it's really helpful to see videos of it so you can understand. I'll show you this quick video of him. This is him perfectly happy, but anybody seeing him or hearing him might think that he's distressed. So I just play that.
Okay. We'll do it one more time.
So as you can see, you know, the noises he makes and his movements, a lot of time people don't understand that. And I just put in here an explanation about his sensory issues and various other things. Oh, one second, what else is in here? Oh, just other videos of him being sensory, really. That's not going to play. I'll go on to the next thing. Communication section contains speech and language information. A link to his most recent speech and language therapy support report is here. How he communicates and what helps. Intensive interaction, some of you may have heard of. And this is more information to help his support staff learn how to communicate with him. Visual support has been helpful in the past, although he doesn't use them so much. The PECS symbols, which some of you may have used, he doesn't use these so much recently. Mostly he uses a whiteboard in which his team write important events and what's working, who's working, that sort of thing. But you could use this wiki or the media section to store all the individualized PECS cards for a person. Okay, so that's Aidan's wiki. Just before I hand over to Gail, I just wanted to show you a couple of other features of the Multi-Me. This is a bit like a safe sort of Facebook, really. It's just, we just put his daily outings, and it's really helpful for everybody to see what he's been up to. So as you can see, he's started living a life again, finally. So that's really good for everybody to see. Also, the media section I find very helpful. This contains lots of videos, and I use it to store his documentation as well. Deputyships, I get asked for that a lot. All of his court of protection deputyships paperwork, and the rest of the stuff is fairly self-explanatory. So so that's his wiki. I've seen families use it to store daily logs and minutes from meetings. You can put whatever you think is important on it. People who are more able may choose to put details of their specific interests on their wiki. There are videos on YouTube of people demonstrating the wikis they've created. I think it's the most person-centered way of getting information across about someone. Easily shared, easily updated. I think everyone like Aidy should have a wiki. Okay, so before I hand over to Gail, does anybody have any questions?
I just want to say you're an amazing woman, but I want to ask, as an autistic person myself, and maybe wanting to make a wiki to share with my PAs, to make sure I get the right help, how would I go about it?
I think that is what Sam is going to talk about later, so I'll leave that to Sam, if that's okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Well, I just want to say that I spoke to I've got a pain psychologist, and I said one thing that we need to do for especially autistic people is get away from the fear. I said autistic people are scared of the word psychology, and it's just the word psychology is not helping. Mm. And you have to talk to all psychologists and just say, look, you're scaring us. And if we get into then the care system, we will go into sensory overload and we will go non-verbal because just for fear.
Yeah. My hope is that, none of your children have the experiences that my son did, but I just wanted to explain what happened because, it just goes to show how the wiki has been so valuable in getting everybody to know all of the good stuff, as I said, rather than lists and lists of where he's failed and where there've been incidents as a result of that.
But thank you so much.
Thank you, Tash, and thank you, Lisa. Natalie, you have a question.
Thank you, Pippa, and thank you, Lisa. I'm taken aback by the journey. It's just it's very hard. I've had a personal experience of things that have been similar, but really what I want to learn about is, in terms of what you've put together now through the wiki, would that have influenced you in getting support, do you feel, and funding sooner if you'd had that put together, going through that journey?
I think it's very hard for people to say, oh, we need to have him admitted because he needs to have his latest, you know, he needs to have this assess or that assess. I think the wiki very plainly shows a very sort of deep understanding of his needs. Yes, I don't, an answer to your question, I'm not sure. It's been a very long journey to get suitable housing for him. And it's not helped that the teams around him have been stood down every time he's been admitted. I think it can only help.
I'm just interested in that in terms of, so for a council, we have the council plan, and everything that we do in terms of commissioning and monitoring is along the lines of key priorities, which are keeping people safe from vulnerable situations, and also enabling people to reach their potential. And I think, you know, what you've got in your wiki is really, you know, super helpful to look at what can make someone healthy and enable them in their day to day. And then also to have that alongside is where, you know, you're risking someone, because what I've understood from your journey, and correct me if I'm wrong in what you presented, is that step by step by step, lots of things could have been prevented if you are enabling someone to access just, and it's not about money necessarily, it's about enabling a person to be in the best position to have opportunities and to feel really properly supported. That what really concerns me is that we end up blaming mental health and putting people on inappropriate medication. And that seems like a simple solution, but it's, you know, these things that you're putting forward, really, I think are absolutely vital. And I wonder, as a council, I'm on the Health and Adult Social Care Scrutiny Committee, and we have very simplified what they call customer journeys. But what you've presented today would be a lot of learning, which would be invaluable to actually improve. And we're not accessing that, I know, at West Sussex enough, I think. And maybe, I don't know what your communications are with the local authority to actually have councillors and decision makers aware of this. I know you've talked about the NHS a lot, but the local authority, how much are they getting involved?
I think
involved?
They're very aware of our situation. I think ultimately, you know, they've got, you know, all areas have got to develop alternatives for when, you know, somebody loses their school place or their support team, or even just family burnout. Because, you know, with people like my son, where there's really no value in having him admitted to hospital, apart from a sort of warehousing situation, it's hugely traumatic and is likely to worsen the whole situation in the long run. So areas just have to work on alternatives, alternative boots on the ground support, actual support workers and places.
It's also the right people around you, though, because I've just come out of hospital recently with a second degree burn on my hand and probably a lifelong injury to my shoulder, because when I was in hospital, nobody gave me the proper care that I needed and I went non-verbal. Mm-hmm. So it can happen to anyone. It's not just someone as severe as your son. It's all autistic people who are all vulnerable in hospital.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Can we, there are questions coming up in the chat, and I think a lot of those questions may be answered as we go through, particularly your presentation, Sam. So could we move on to Gail?
Yeah. Hi. Hello. My name is Gail Hanrahan. I am the manager of Oxfordshire Family Support Network, which I set up with Jan Summan, who's here on the call, many years ago now, back in 2007, I think we started. And we support families of people with learning disabilities across all ages. And we run training and workshops for families. And we do family support information and advice. And as Lisa said, I've been working, supporting Lisa for a number of years now, not only with kind of person-centered planning work and family champions work that Lisa has done with us, but supporting her through a situation with with Aidan and feeling like I'm not doing anything because we didn't seem to get anywhere for quite a long time, did we? But I'm also a parent. I have three adult children. My middle son, Guy, will be 32 next month, and he has a profound learning disability and doesn't use words to communicate, and lives in supported living. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what we've done in Oxfordshire to try and bring families together, to help them use the Wiki, and how we've worked alongside our local authority and our local health services to bring them on board too, because we think it's really important that professionals and families work together on this. So I'm really pleased to see some people from services here as well. So hopefully that will be helpful. I'm not going to take too long because I think Sam's presentation is going to be far more interesting than what I have to share now, so I'm going to keep it really brief. If I can have permission to share my screen though, because I can't share my screen at the moment. Really helpful. Yeah, great. Okay. Can everyone see that? Yeah, great. Okay, so I do have a video that I can share in the chat. Can't multitask, so I'll do it in the break if that's all right. I've got a video of the end of our session that we did in Oxfordshire. We did some training for families about 2019, between April and June, and we brought families together with professionals that work locally to do this training. And we did this with a guy called Charlie Levinson, who runs MultiMe, which is the Wiki and MultiMe. Rick's Wiki and MultiMe work jointly together. And we got some funding through Rick's to develop this training, run this training locally. So that was, as I say, 2019. There is a video of our kind of show and tell session that we did at the end with parents talking. So that might be quite interesting for you to see later on. So Oxfordshire Family Support Network, as I said, we're a family carer-led charity. We've been set up and run by family carers of people with learning disabilities. We're independent and we provide advice and support for families and workshops and training for professionals. We run working with families training, person-centred planning training. Main bit about Oxfordshire Family Support Network is helping families navigate those complex systems, which we struggle, even as people who work in a system that's supposed to be helping others to navigate it. We struggle to navigate it ourselves because it changes all the time. But that's basically what we try to do, help families get through those different systems through health, education and social care. Everything we do is rooted in person-centred practice, which is why I was so drawn to the Wiki and the MultiMe, because as a parent, I've been doing person-centred planning for my son probably for the last 20 years, and have been trained as a facilitator in person-centred practice and running training for other people. So for me, having somewhere to put that plan was really key, and struggling to get people to read. You know, a plan is only as good as the person that is going to be reading it and enacting it. Otherwise, it just becomes another plan that sits with a person and doesn't get read. So the idea that with a Wiki, you can dip in and out of it and share bits of it and not other bits of it, I really appealed to me. I don't use the Wiki for my own son because he's got his own setup where he lives, and I didn't want to interfere with that because it works really well for him. So if it isn't fixed, if it isn't broken, don't fix it. But I love the idea of this working for people, and my role has been trying to bring people together to use it. That's a little about us. This is us doing the training. So this is Charlie. So we had the lovely Cara there with a learning disability who came along with a PA. We had parents, we had siblings, and we had professionals. We had three or four professionals that worked at Oxford Health in the room as well. And they talk about the benefits of it in that film that I mentioned. But we really value that idea. We try as much as possible to do parents and professionals in the room training together, because it just adds so much more value when you understand each other's perspectives. And it's really helpful to have that training where you have, as I say, the professionals and parents together, whether it's in a non assessment or non-clinical type setting. It literally is people getting to know each other on a human level, which I think is really important. So what we did and what we're doing now, so we had four sessions. We looked at things like consent and the mental capacity in line with the Mental Capacity Act. It's really important that if you're doing this for somebody else or with somebody else, that you get their consent if they're able to give consent, or if what you're sharing is viewed to be you're sharing it in their best interests. So there are issues around privacy and data sharing under the GDPR. There's lots of information out there about what can and can't be shared, but permissions can be sought, and if it is in someone's best interest, it shouldn't be a barrier to sharing. But I'm sure Sam will go into that later on in more detail. So we looked at that in the first session to get started. We looked at the WIKI tool. We looked at the circle and the diary. Each week we covered the different tools. We've got funding to start a new online course, which will be starting at the end of May 2022. I will get in touch with Katie after this. If we've got spaces left over, it's Oxfordshire families that we generally work with. But if there are any spaces left over, happy to open it up to other people if they want to take part. And it will be online. And as I said, there's our online video that we can share. So why we think it works. So everyone that had done our course had already done person-centered thinking and planning, a course that we run, and it's rooted in that. It really fits well with that way of working because everything is about that person, and it has to be that detail that is needed. Everyone's talked about having the, you know, box files and filing cabinet full of information about the person, but having all of that again in one place, but the detail of that, the person-centered detail, the videos, the pictures, all of that information is really key. So bringing people together, person-centered thinking and planning training, along with the technical know-how. So we had Charlie there, who's telling us everyone how to work it. We also involved two family carers. So Lisa came along and another parent, Frances, who used the WIKI to talk about how it works and to share their knowledge with other parents, so that passing it on type of way of working, getting other parents to share what they've learned with other families. Again, as I said, having professionals in the room, it's not only good to bring them on board, but it also helped us discuss what are some of the barriers that they might have. So a lot of professionals would say, well, not sure how this is going to speak or fit with our tech system. So understanding what those barriers meant for the services meant that we could literally look at how we could overcome some of those barriers. So having the professionals there for that was really important. And this is just what some of the parents said. So they talk about this in the film, but it's the comments from them were just the most important. And I'm sure Sam will go into much more detail. From what I understand, there's no reason why you can't approach and do the MultiMe or Rick's WIKI and ask to do the same, the Rick Centre to do the same for you. If it might be easier to get a group of parents together to do it and do it jointly, maybe charge people. We didn't charge because we got the funding, but it was really simple to set up this particular training for people. And I think that there's a real willingness for this to be used and rolled out more. So again, I think Sam will probably go into more detail about that. And yeah, that's me. I did say I was going to be brief. I hope I've been brief enough. Stop sharing now. But yeah, happy to take any questions if anyone's got any questions on that.
Thank you so much, Gail. Together with Lisa, you've given us a really good start and a really good picture of how useful and positive this could be. I'm going to suggest now, if anyone has questions, if they could pop them in the chat, and we just take 5 minutes to go to the toilet, get yourselves a drink, and then we'll come straight back to you, Sam. So it is 12:15 now. So if we could start at 20:20. So it's just a quick run, a quick stretch, get what you need, a little snack, and we'll see you back here at 12:20. and we'll go straight to Sam. Any questions, please put in the chat. Introductions and get going. Thank you for being with us, Sam.
Thank you. I'm absolutely delighted to be with all these lovely parents today. And I have to say, you know, I was very moved by Lisa's story and the love she has for her son. And I think that's what drives us all. You know, there's no greater motivation than love. So how I got involved with Rick's Wikis, you know, about in 2010, I was working with my parent carer forum. I was on the transitions board and I was up at London Councils and I learned about Wikis. And back then, Wikis were used to share information for people with learning disabilities about different services. So they weren't used for person-centered planning. And I saw a real opportunity, you know, for, I was actually looking for something. You know, my son was coming up to 14, you know, that transition period, you know, I'd spoken to other parents of older children. I was worried about the cliff edge and I wanted planning for my son to be based on him as a person and not his list of diagnosis. So when I saw this technology, I thought, you know, this could be a very good person-centered plan. So I did some training with the university and I kind of have supported them along that journey ever since. So Shane was 14, he was coming up to his annual review and I knew new people would start coming. People I called the scary people from adult services were going to start coming along and we'd be discussing, you know, Shane's future. And so I developed a wiki for Shane. And about him as a person, you know, what he likes, what he dislikes, what motivates him, what his dreams and aspirations were, what type of life we wanted for him. And I haven't looked back. I've been using it now for over 10 years. A couple of years ago, I was the national patient lead for the development of health and social care standards for the NHS, and one of the standards we developed was called About Me, and it's specifically about sharing the right information to improve the quality of health and care. And now I'm on the National Data Guardian panel as the patient of public voice, again, pushing forward the need for sharing the right information to improve care for our lovely sons and daughters. So I'd like to take over the screen now, if that's okay. And I'll just start by sharing one short video and then talk a little bit more in detail on the impact sharing the right information can have on somebody's life. And like everybody here, you know, who supports somebody with needs, we all have ups and downs, we all have battles and things we have to fight for. But I would like to share how technology has kind of helped me along that journey and made some changes in decisions and changes in attitudes along the way.
And Shane, who's 21. He's very funny. You know, I think about 3 years ago, we started to develop this really fun sense of humor. And he's also the most affectionate person I know. It's so lovely when I go in and call him in the morning and the first thing he does is give me a big hug. He's really proud when he's able to do something on his own. And sometimes he'll push me away because it's like, no, Mom, this, you know, I can do this myself. And sometimes he'll sit on the top stair and then he'll call me. Shane can say mama, it's the only word he can say. And what he wants is me to sit beside him and give him a hug. And it just starts my day in such a positive way. After that, Shane goes to his annex. He's there between the hours of 9 and 4 every day, and he's supported by Max. And at various times during the week, we have a 2-to-1 support, which enables Shane to access the community safely. Shane starts every day with a tack pack session. This is really great for Shane to have his sensory needs met, and he always feels happy and relaxed afterwards. 3 times a week, Shane does what we call the big walk. The walk is up to 3 miles long. On the way, Shane will stop and smell flowers, touch trees, and some days he will pop into our local co-op and buy his ingredients for a baking activity. After Shane was born, about 25 hours later, he started to have a seizure, and he ended up in intensive care. Shane had meningitis. He spent a little over a month in hospital, and on discharge, he was diagnosed with cerebral palsy. When Shane was 8 months old, he got diagnosed with optic nerve damage and cortical visual impairment. Shane is registered blind, and cognitively, he's about 2.5 to 3 years old. As a parent of a young person with complex needs, it's really important for us that those who work with Shane, they understand him as a person. Yes, his diagnosis and his help needs are important, but they're not as important as what's important to Shane. They have to see him first and his disability second. Before we employ new people, we always share Shane's wiki. Shane's wiki is very comprehensive, and it covers lots of information about our family, Shane's health needs, but most importantly about Shane as a person, what he likes, what he dislikes, what makes him happy, how he interacts with people, and they get a really good picture and an insight into how best to support Shane, but also when not to support him. Just pulling up a zip on his coat, that's independence for him because it's a skill he's learned. And we don't want somebody doing that for them. This is the type of information you're not going to get on a medical report. By having everything in one place, new people coming to work with Shane will get that insight before they start. I'm almost like preparing for the future, preparing for a time that I really find quite hard to think about, a time in the future when I'll no longer be here. Having all of that information in one place means that when I'm no longer here, that can be passed on to whoever looks after Shane. I'm really proud and happy to say Shane is one of the happiest people I know. Now that his needs are met, he's stimulated, he's surrounded by people who love him, and he's supported by those who really understand him as a person, what's important to him.
Sorry, I'm just trying to get onto something else now.
This
Sorry.
Revolutionary new device.
I may need to stop and go back in. Sorry about that. Oh, why does that go on? Sorry about that. Yes, I've worked it out now. I'm used to Teams, not Zoom. So yeah, so the one thing for me, you know, when we started using the wiki, it was people remembered Shane. He was no longer a name on a piece of paper, you know. When before his annual reviews, Shane used to be invited into the room and he would stay 2 minutes. And he would leave. the environment wasn't inviting for him. He didn't feel comfortable. There was a load of adults sitting around with pieces of paper on the table. But once we introduced the Wiki, Shane was then now an active participant. And all through school, from year 9 till he left, he used to stay 30 minutes. And he would share his Wiki and share his achievements. And nobody was looking at pieces of paper. They were focusing on Shane. And the second year, when he was using the Wiki, it was really a lovely experience for me. Because when we set the Wiki up, his brother was 11. And he was really excited about the Wiki. I've got a touch screen. I'm after doing something there. Is there a way I can get rid of the pictures of the people in the corner? Sorry, everybody.
Sam, if you just click on the link, if you go up to the top and hover it over where the pictures are, there's some little boxes. If you just bring, you can hide thumbnail videos.
Oh, perfect. Thank you so much.
No worries.
Thank you so much. So as you can see, I'm not a techie person. You know, I use this software because it works for my son. So I think I've just kind of shown you don't need to be a really techie person to kind of have this. Okay, so here, this is just a little clip of Shane at his annual review where his brother actually came along to support him.
Hey. Do you want to show everyone your Wiki for Shane? Shane, you ready for toilet for Shane? I stand up, Shane. Shane, I stand up. I toilet for Shane. Toilet for Shane. I stand up. Good boy, Shane. Ella, step, Shane. Good boy. Good boy, Shane.
So one thing that I've always kind of spoken about with professionals over the years is any type of planning has to focus on the aspiration, you know. And Shane, as you saw in the video, he had 10 years of operations at Great Ormond Street. He had 3 hip operations. His last one was a hip reconstruction. And the reason he had those operations was so he could be as mobile as possible and have as much independence physically. So this particular the year before, as Shane's hip was now in the right place, he was now able to physically sit on the toilet for the first time. So our aspiration was that he would become more independent in the bathroom. And one of the outcomes that we set was he would learn how to independently sign toilet. At that time, it used to take Shane up to 12 months to learn a sign. So at the annual review, he was able to show a video of him signing toilet, and he showed everybody. And yay, finally, there was finally an opportunity to actually celebrate with Shane, for people to actually see that he's achieved something. And sometimes with people like Shane, you know, small steps can be missed, but when we add them all together, they can have a big impact on his life. So that year we worked on him signing toilet, and he was physically able to sit on the toilet because he had all his operations. And then with the MOVE program at school, which was Movement Opportunities via Education, we wanted him to work on a pivoting so he'd be able to stand up from the toilet, turn around and walk to the hand basin and wash his hands. Now, altogether, it took 3 years for Shane to achieve this. But wow, what a difference in the quality of life it made. So we always talk about, long-term aspirations, and make sure that people are working with us together, that the things we're working on are meaningful to him. So the following year, Daniel was then, he was actually in secondary school and he couldn't get the day off. So he actually sent in a message to be played at the annual review. And he started off by telling the speech and language therapist off for talking too long at the previous meeting. And then he gave a recommendation, which I was quite shocked at. At this time, Shane had about 5 signs, and it used to take him about a year to learn a sign. And Daniel suggested that we teach him the sign for Haribo jellies, because he saw that Haribo jellies were important to him. And, you know, as a parent, you can imagine, I could think of, you know, 100 things that were more important to me for him to learn. But Daniel recognised what was important to Shane, so we listened. And what I learned from Daniel, who was 12, was we can never underestimate anybody's opinion in a circle of support. Shane learned the sign for Haribo jellies in 6 weeks because he was motivated by it. And from then, the time it took for him to learn got shorter because he was getting the reward he wanted. So one thing that I think that the Wiki does is it brings people together to share their points of view, and it gives an opportunity for everyone to reflect. But I would say that we can never discount anybody's contribution, because sometimes it's the people we least expect come up with, you know, just the best ideas. And we used our annual review then to, you know, we started taking control of the meetings, and we start to look at, you know, this meeting is for Shane. I remember when Daniel left after supporting his brother at the meeting, and he said to me, "Mom, before Shane had a Wiki, how did he participate?" And I said, "Well, he didn't." Daniel was 11 when he 12 when he attended, and I said, and he said, "Well, that's bizarre, Mom. The meeting is all about him." He could see how important it was that Shane had a way to participate in the planning that was about his life. You know, it was a really powerful thing for me to listen to my 12-year-old son basically saying it's bizarre that he was never there before, you know. So what one meeting that we talk about, you know, we were also thinking about, you know, holistic outcomes and what was important to Shane and us as a family. And we really wanted Shane to make his confirmation. And I'll just share this short little video with you.
Heard there was a zebra port, day to play, and then please the Lord. You don't really care for music, do ya? It goes like this, the fourth and fifth, the minor four and the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof. The beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to her kitchen chair. She broke your throne and she cut your hair. And from your lips she drew the
So when we were at the annual review, you know, I shared, you know, one of our aspirations, and, you know, small reasonable adjustments were needed in our church for Shane to be part of that. And if Shane hadn't had a disability, he may have gone to a Catholic school and he would have been supported by his peers and everyone planning together. So just changing art lessons where his friends could help him do his homework, you know, it wasn't a lot of changes that needed to happen. But unless people know what your aspirations are, you know, everybody's different. Everybody has different ideas and dreams and things they'd like to achieve. And unless they're discussed and people are willing to listen and come together to help each other, to help Shane, you know, achieve those things. Our local area was one of the pathfinders before the SEN reforms in 2014. And we trialled personal budget. And one thing I spent our money on was on spiritual music sessions for Shane, which was really, really beneficial. Now, when we moved into adult services and we were looking at a personal budget and saying what we'd like to spend it on, when I put these sessions down, it got rejected. And I was told, well, we've never done that before. And I said, well, you've never had Shane before, you know? And having evidence of the benefit to Shane, the panel changed their mind, you know? Now I hope, now that we're a few more years into local authorities getting more used to different ways of working and being more personalised, I would hope another family wouldn't have that battle. But I found by having evidence of the benefit to Shane, that helped us get that decision overturned. Now, in Shane has cerebral palsy, and we also have on his video contributions from professionals. So we had, after his hip reconstruction, his physiotherapist did a video about his rehabilitation. So there's lots of different ways you can get other people involved. But one of the short videos on here that I think had one of the biggest impacts for Shane over the years was this short video about how to put his ankle foot orthotics on correctly. This little video is 47 seconds long. It took me 20 minutes to make. So when I speak to families about, you know, content for wikis, I always talk about what would be the impact if certain information wasn't shared. So for Shane, if his splints aren't put on correctly, he gets blisters. And then he's in pain, you know, they're sore. He can't wear his AFOs. Can't walk, he's not independent, he suffers from chronic constipation, being mobile is part of maintaining, you know, good bowel function. And on one occasion, he actually ended up impacted and in hospital. So it's a big thing. So by having this video, sharing it with people who work with Shane, so say in a school setting, if somebody doesn't know how to put the splints on correctly, we're not waiting for a visiting physio who may only pop in once a week with 20 people on a caseload. You know, it makes things so much easier, quicker, and most important, is which is the only thing I'm interested in, is that Shane gets the best support possible. Now, at the beginning, you saw that video where I mentioned, like, Shane is one of the happiest people I know. He had a really good experience at secondary school. When I created the wiki, I used it at his school for his year 9 annual review. Within a week, the head teacher got a contract with WIKS. Now every student in the school has a wiki, because they could see how beneficial it was. But sadly, Shane went on to college, and that was our plan A, and he didn't have a good experience at college. They didn't look at the information, and his placement broke down. And it was one of the most difficult times of our life. The staff weren't properly trained. They didn't understand Shane's communication. It's like, you know, not understanding how Shane communicates is like having a person apply for a job in the UK that needs English, who doesn't speak English. You know, if you want to work with Shane, you have to learn his language. The Wiki has all his signs, pictures, videos, explaining how he signs, what they mean. So there isn't an excuse for poor support. So for example, Shane uses the Makaton sign for Daniel. If he signs Daniel and you don't answer him, you'll if you don't respond to him, he'll start banging his head. And then people talk to us about challenging behavior. And like Lisa, I hate the word challenging behavior. I want to know what was the barrier to positive behavior. And the barrier in that incident would be poor support. People not understanding how Shane communicates. It really is just not acceptable. You know, if you want to work with him, you learn his signs. If you don't understand them, you ask, you watch the video.
I have a question.
So when the placement broke down, you know, Shane, I'm not going to sugarcoat it, he was traumatized. He wasn't where, he was refusing to wear his AFOs, he was refusing to wear parts of his clothing. He stopped communicating because people weren't responding to his communication. So he was resorting to other forms of communication, which were very, very difficult to manage. He started self-harming a number of times during the day. And it was very sad. And I started a trauma recovery plan with him. This would probably be a presentation for another day. But before Shane could, you know, reintegrate and learn to live his life again, he had to feel safe. He had to feel loved. He had to feel listened to. And what we gave him was that time to recover. I didn't see the behavior as the problem. I saw the behavior as the symptom. The problem was poor support. And I think a lot of people can get hooked up on trying to solve behavior, looking at that as the problem instead of looking at it as the symptom and really thinking about why somebody has changed how they react. If someone's behavior changes to something that is not normal for them, there is something wrong and we must stop and listen and try to understand. My aim was not to fix Shane's behavior. My aim was to go back to the aspirations that we had. The aim was a good life for Shane. And that's what I did. I went back to the aspirations we had before the placement broke down. And that's what we focused on. And that's what our goal was.
In this proud land we grew up strong. We were wanted all along. I was taught to fight, taught to win. I never thought I could fail. No fight left, or so it seems. I am a man whose dreams have all deserted. I've changed my face, I've changed my name, but no one wants you where you lose.
Don't give up, cause you have faith. Don't give up, you're not weak. Don't give up, I know you can make it good.
Though I saw it all around, never thought that I could be a failure. as daylight broke, I saw the earth. The trees had burned down to the ground.
Don't give up, you still have us. Don't give up, we don't need much of anything. Don't give up, 'cause somewhere there's a place where we belong. Rest your head, you worry too much. It's gonna be alright. When times get rough, you can't fall back on us. Don't give up. Please don't give up.
Got to walk out of here.
Everybody has a different story to tell, and information that can seem a high priority for one of us might not seem a high priority for one person, can be, you know, a high priority for somebody else. And in the video you saw how we start each day with tech pack session, and this works really, really well for Shane. And by starting a day with the tech pack session, it just puts Shane in such a calm, relaxed way. And Shane had a needle phobia, and before when he was going to have his COVID vaccinations, I was really worried. And I found by doing a tech pack session before we went, he actually tolerated it. 3 weeks ago, Shane had to have a blood test. And it is the first time we've managed to have a blood test without him being sedated, because he's in that more relaxed, happy kind of state. So this is the type of information that's on Shane's wiki. So here you can see all the different activities he does. He still is the happiest person I know, because he has the right support. Because the people who are with him, they understand him. They understand him as a person. They understand how he communicates. They understand what he likes doing. Everybody who's working with him, we share the wiki beforehand, so they get a really good insight. So they already know his signs before they start working with him. So he's not getting frustrated. I could talk all day about information sharing and the importance of it. And it's what I advocate for all the time. But it is only a piece of technology. You know, it's like a mobile phone. Some people make a phone call on it and use, you know, WhatsApp. Other people, you know, have their whole life on it. It's about how we use it. So who we share the information, you know, how people engage with it, and obviously the quality of information that's on there. And like I said, for everybody, that would be different. But I'll keep quiet now in a minute. Good care has never been enough for me. You know, good care just keeps you alive and safe. Improved care and support for me is where you're listened to and you're valued and you're understood, and your goals and your health ambitions are taken into account, and support is offered to you to help you achieve them.
Thank you so much, Sam. I'm going to jump in there just because we are nearly at 1 o'clock. and we had planned to finish at one. What I'm going to suggest is that for those of you who can and would like to, we stay on till 1:15 and can take questions. But of course, if you have to leave, we completely understand and we apologise for overrunning. We will, if there are questions in the chat, we can send them round later and see if we can get back to you with responses to your questions. Is that okay, everyone? If we stay on for 15 minutes, but we'll say goodbye to those of you who have to go. And if we just take, and if people are mindful when they're talking now, that we only have these 15 minutes and then we will have to close the session. Please do put questions in the chat. As I say, we'll try to get back with responses to your questions via email later on this week. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Gail. Thank you, Lisa. Amazing presentations. So much information. So who has a question? If you could just put your hand up either physically or put the little hand emoji. Jane, let's come to you. We need you to unmute yourself, Jane, please.
I was trying to work out where my hand was then. I've put some things in the chat. I've just a thought about whether anything like Wiki would be available on an app, because I see a great kind of use for people who are really busy that can't go on a computer, but sitting there with their smartphone, just adding things in, whether that can actually be used. No, I obviously videos and things could be, but actually inputting information in any way, or a kind of small app that helps people.
Shall I answer that, Jane? It is an app. Yeah, and you can.
It's an app.
Oh, right.
Okay.
It's probably easier actually, because most of us have our videos and photos on our phone.
Because people don't. Okay, brilliant.
Could I just jump in there? Technically, it is not an app that you download an app. You can go onto it using your browser and then use it and sweep in your photos and videos. However, I can tell you there is plans for development of an app, but it'll probably take another 12 months.
Can I also ask, there are several questions in the chat about this, the cost. Is there a cost to this, and what is that cost?
Yes, I can say there are two different ways you can go about it. Lots of local areas or schools or colleges or organisations, they buy a package of support and then they do that directly with RICS, and that's where you get X amount of wikis, etc. What I would suggest, that if anybody is interested, they share with you their names and their local area, and we will try and see if there is a project in that local area. However, parents can buy one-off licenses, which cost, I believe, about £70 for a wiki, or I think it's per annum, and I think it's £130 if you have the full suite of tools that that Lisa has. But on a first instant, I would definitely recommend that we try and see if near your area somebody has a package that you could kind of tap into.
Thanks, Sam. That is a great offer. So if you could email me after the session and just let me know where you are, and then we will respond to that. We'll work with Sam and respond to that. Gail, can we come to you? You've got your hand up.
Yeah. So from the MultiMe, if you go onto the MultiMe site, there is a bit that says about free trials. So there's a month free and then you pay for the rest. I think the paying for it is the thing that sometimes is the barrier for some families, and they really worry about how they're going to pay for it, because it can be like 100, like Sam said, £120, £130 a year. feels like a lot of money, mm-hmm. but you can do it through your personal budget. So mm-hmm. if your young person has a direct payments, it should be seen as part of their mm-hmm. support plan, and you mm-hmm. can argue for that when you're mm-hmm. literally looking at their budget, looking at their support. It should be seen as a vital, essential part of their support needs, so mm-hmm. they can be funded through the local authority if you work yeah. work with them on it.
Thank you, Gail. Natalie, could we come to you, please?
Thank you, Pippa. Just to jump on that, in terms of local authorities, have there been any, does anyone know that local authorities have actually worked with this and commissioned it? Because I mean, it very much along the lines of co-production and what they want to be actually improving assessment process and everything else. So it'd be interesting to know whether there's been interest.
Yes, our local authority did do that in Oxfordshire some years ago. In fact, that's the first time I saw Sam's son, Shane, because it was the AFO bit that grabbed me. I thought, yes, this is brilliant. But our local authority did. Unfortunately, some of the schools took it over. Some of the schools did it, not many individual families. And what we found locally is that once the person left school, they left their WIKI as well. And that's not the whole point of a person-centred plan, however, whichever form. Format it is, but Oxfordshire have done it, and when we did our training session, that's why we brought in the commissioners to our show and tell session with them. So we said, would you fund it, and they have agreed that they will fund individuals, people's through their budget, which is why I'm from what I said before. But yeah, they commissioned a whole 200 or whatever number, they a set number.
Thank you, Gail. Sam, I think you wanted to respond to that as well.
Yes, I can confirm big, large packages over the years. We've had about 22 local authorities, and there's about 25 schools, and I'm currently working with four at the moment on projects. So I see there's various comments around this. So could I possibly suggest that everybody sends everything to Pippa, and then Pippa can send me everything back, if that's okay?
Yeah. That's great. We will do that, Sam. Any more questions or comments for now? No? I think everyone, it's just been an amazing morning. Thank you. Thank you, Lisa, Gail and Sam, for you've just introduced us to something new. So useful, and I've really appreciated just so many examples of the way you use it. And I think the videos, the music, the messages, you can put so much across in one short video clip. Pamela, I saw that you'd put your hand up. Do you want to say something, Pamela?
Actually, it was just applause to say thank you. Absolutely brilliant. Thank you.
Okay, on that note, Pamela, thank you for that. On that note, let's leave today's session. As Sam has suggested, please send your comments. I'm going to go through the chat later on. Jan, sorry, I'll come to you. If you could come off mute, Jan.
Just applause, not a comment.
Okay. Fabulous. Yeah. So I think everyone is really appreciating the session, your time, your sharing, your energy, and your generosity.
Pippa, sorry, can I just mention, somebody said in the chat about taking it back to the parent carer forum. We manage our local parent carer forum here, and we know that they get their funding. It might be something that they would want to do. So if anyone wants to get in touch with me to see how we did it locally, more than happy to kind of share our experiences mm-hmm. and how we went about it with them.
That's a great offer. Thank you. Thank you, Gail. So we will follow up on all that. Thank you all so much for coming. Thank you to our presenters. Good luck with it, guys. It's a great thing that I think we can share and use. So thank you all. We will be in touch.
Thank you, everybody. Have a good rest of the holiday.